Hi, this is Bruce, and welcome to my tutorial on the Mad Dog X MD-80. This is a video for myself, because if I don't fly this for a long time, it's nice to have a quick review. Probably in about 35 minutes I can accomplish this up to taxi ready, and I hope to might benefit some others, so I'm sharing it. The ceiling is 37,000 feet, the range is a little over 2,000 nautical miles, speed is about 500. 80 passengers, 2,500 pounds of cargo, and before you load it, you need to do the load manager first with the fuel, cargo, passenger distribution, and that sort of thing to make sure that all the centers of gravity are accurately noted. And for me, I know it was 15.5 in the purple numbers there in the box under CG. So let's go ahead and press ahead, cold and dark condition. If we wanted to see our exterior doors, you can hit Shift 1. There's a little door figure here. All the greens are closed. If we were to click on one of them, you would see them open and close. They all function very well. Let's go ahead then and pop into the pilot and command position. Cold and dark. Shift 1 takes care of that little pop out there. Looking at this, the yokes really don't cover too much. There's just a few light switches and things down here. But if we did want to get rid of them, Shift 1 brings up this panel. Click on this second box. They go right away. Shift 1, and that little pop out's gone. Going to set the parking brake, left click, then we're going to go up to the overhead, and this is probably where we're going to spend a good little bit of time now. So first of all, battery. In the APU, very almost center section below the midline is the battery switch. Left click turns our battery on. Then we'll want the ground services to get our external APU going. Excuse me, I have to hit the proper button there. And it's way up here at the top left corner, almost out of sight. Left click on the maintenance interphone, then right click on the mech call. See all your options.
Sir. We're going to connect the GPU, to the GPU. Please.
Stand by.
Now what we're going to wait for is this blue light to turn on, and when it does, we'll left click on the external power on. And for fire suppression, we'll go ahead and put it on loop B.
GPU connected.
I don't have anything set up for any failings, so we won't need those, but just to follow procedures. So that's it for right now. Up here at the top, we'll go back down in then to the main overhead section. We'll turn on, see this blue light here? Coincides with the one we saw above, external power available. We're gonna left click on external right bus, external left bus. You hear a little test signal, don't worry about it. Gallery switch, left click on, then over to the right of the attendant call. Left click on anti-skid, go down 45 degrees to the yaw damper, and we'll turn that on. Then we'll go down to the very bottom of the overhead, and we'll turn on the anti-ice and the anti-fog under the windshield. Seat belts are down in the very bottom left corner. Right click brings it up to auto in each case, and then emergency lights arm with a left click. You could just turn on the seat belts and no smoking, but I prefer to use the auto. Emergency lights then are armed. Air conditioned panel is right here, clearly labeled. A cockpit temp should be auto, cabin temp should be auto. Supplies, which are sort of like packs, I think, in other aircraft, are off. Maybe they're exact same thing. And then down here, the air conditioned auto shutoff should be on auto. So that takes care of that. The cabin door auto unlock is here, right there. Right click to deny, it immediately pops back to auto. That little indicator goes out. If we wanted to see our door conditions, we can right click on attendant call and let's just do the PA emergency
and emergency light test.
And
emergency lights
off. Left click on that. And then if we wanted to see the doors, this is another way to do it. And you can open just by clicking on any of the greens. Or again, Shift 1 pulls up that little panel there. So that's about all we need to do. Then down here under ice protection, right click it or mouse wheel it to the captain. That's not telling you what gets heat, it just tells you the current that's going to each one. So we could click right through all of those if we wanted to. They're all on, but the current meter right here is all we're interested in. The right aft fuel pump then can be turned on. The start pump can be turned on. We're heading for the APU here. The APU and the APU section master switch, turn it to start, and then it automatically kicks back to run. There are two ways to find out if it's working. One, you can watch your RPM meter here go up to about 100 or about 100 there. And the exhaust gas temp's going to end up right about in here. Or you could pop outside and listen for the whine. And you can catch just a whiff of a dark exhaust that'll eventually briefly appear right in here. But I'm not going to wait for it because I don't want the thing to last forever. But those are two ways to see it. There's your RPMs coming up. Exhaust gas temp is coming up just great. So now we can turn on the left bus and the right bus for the APU. We can turn off the external power buses. Then we can turn on the APU air, and the APU switch here should be on norm. And then going way back up to the top left again, we're going to call our mech call right click, and we're going to disconnect
the
GPU.
Yes, sir. Clear to disconnect. Thanks.
Now we can turn off our maintenance interphone. We can turn on our APU power button, and we can turn off or leave that off, our ground external power. I might not have turned that on at the start, I'm thinking, but if I did, I missed it. That should have been turned on right then and there. So, back down then to the main overhead section. Engine sync is up here. It should be straight up to off. Ground proximity warning switch is right here. It's on norm. That's a preset. The mech trim comp should be on norm, which is just right of the attendant call, which will be right down here, and it is up on norm. The radio stack fan switch right here should be under air conditioning, should be on fan. And then static air will be down where the pilot is, down to the left lower section. It's already preset on norm, but just to show you where it is, it's right there. And then the only other thing we're going to do right here at this, from this angle point of view, is going to involve a lever that's out of sight from this angle. So we're going to move it around to the co-pilot side, and suddenly this yellow handle appears out of nowhere, seemingly. It's got two positions if you left-click it, backwards and forwards. You need to leave it in the forward position. That's your rudder hydraulics. So that's where that will stay. In addition to, we're going to go ahead and left-click on the hydraulics here, the hydraulic pumps. We want the aux on. If that's not on, the rear stairs will go down, but they'll never retract, and you may wonder why. This has to be on for that to work. All right, then let's go back to the pilot in command position. And we'll back off a little bit so we can see. This little panel here is what's going to brighten up our PFD and our ND. So primary flight display, just rolling that mouse wheel to the right, brightens that right up. And then the external gray, light gray, roll that to the right with the mouse wheel. And there it comes with the ND. The compass rose is showing up. The weather is right here on an overlay. And I'll just run it up now. Now, because the co-pilot and the pilot are separate, if you wanted to, you run up the PFD for the co-pilot and the similar thing for the ND. There we go. And since we're over here, we'll go ahead and turn the flight director on, and then back over to the pilot. Turn the flight director on here. There, you've got to work both sides. Okay, now, just a brief discussion about the heading and the altitude and the vertical speed. The little sleeve here is your angle of bank, so 10, 15, 20, 25, and 30. 20 to 25, I'll leave it on 20. If it's on 15, it's really a shallow bank, and it takes forever to turn this thing around. So I prefer something a little steeper. I'm going to run the vertical speed here up to 2,000 is a good place to start. And the altitude, rolling my mouse wheel forward, we'll bring it down to 5. Interestingly enough, if you were to right-click either one of these, they go in, right? What that does is it takes manual control over the FMC's autopilot. So let's say, for instance, I wanted to turn to 275, and I'm flying due north, 000. I can right-click it. That holds that in manual mode now in a heading select. And you can see heading hold. Shouldn't have said select because that's a different thing, but it puts it into a hold. Then, using my wheel, I can turn it down towards 275, but it moves rather slowly. If you hold the tab, it just races. It's a speed-up feature. In fact, I even overshot. So we'll put it back to there. And then if you right-click it, it pushes it, or pulls it out, and now you can see heading select. So in, heading hold, that's a right-click, left-click, heading select. The aircraft now will turn to 275. Same thing over here for the altitude. Push it in, we'll hold the altitude that I'm at, pull it out with a left click. Now you can see it's all dialed in at 5,000 right here. So that's just a little helpful note on that piece. Since we're looking at it, nose and landing lights are all here. These extend the lights but don't turn them on. clear down does turn them on. So just put back to off. And then nose is obvious. I'll turn off that caution because that's related to this business here. And there is external power access door. So we'll take care of that later. I think we're at the point now where we can continue on down through the FMC. So I'll click on the screen for the FMC, pause in it. We're at KCMH, enter it into the soft key, there it is. This is not an IRS related aircraft, it's GPS in terms of positional awareness. So we'll click on those figures there. They're put in the box. Now we'll put them into these empties by clicking next to them. There we go, now it knows where we are. The route will need a destination. In this case, it's K-Pitt, Pittsburgh. Not a very long flight. And we'll be taking off on 28 right, or R. Airways would go in this column. Waypoints, VORs go in this column if needed. I'm gonna be departing, obviously, from KCMH. 28 right, there is no SID, so now we're gonna click departure arrival. Here's Pitt, arrive. We're gonna land on 28 right, ILS. We're gonna use the Fuga 4 28B arrival, standard terminal arrival route with a CTW VOR as our transition entry point for that star. And then for our approach, we're gonna choose NASTY as a waypoint. Now, if we were to look at the legs, here they all are, and if we go to the next page, you'll see this vector here at the bottom, which then leads to NASTY as the next waypoint. That's because after Sydney, we're continuing on that heading until we're given our base and final turns by ATC. And then we'll come up to NASTY and on our final approach. Now, if we wanted to get rid of that vector, we could just click delete. It'll show up down here, and then click on that, and it will give us some empty boxes, which I'll show you shortly. To see if your routing makes any sense, you can go down here and roll it to plan, which shows up in this window here. I'll broaden it out. Now this step will automatically appear. Watch, it'll go away when I put it back to rows. It just says activate. Let's go to plan, step shows up, and I just click next to step. Watching down here, it'll just go from step to step, waypoint to waypoint to waypoint to waypoint, until of course you get to Sydney, and there's that continuing line out there. In fact, we'll just extend out our compass a little bit, or our distances a little bit, so you can see more clearly. There's NASTY right there, so we'll be given vectors to come around. If we wanted to connect those, we could. We're just gonna go ahead then and get it out of step mode, put it back on rows, we'll go ahead and delete. Vectors, now they're gone, empty boxes. The answer's on the next page, because NASTY's gonna go in those boxes, so I'll put it down here. Then I'm gonna go back a page, and we'll stick it in those boxes. And now we'll put it back on our plan. And you see now we have a connecting line, there is no discontinuity. So that's how you roll through all of those, and activate, and we'll execute. And then we'll go to init ref, and we got all of these figures now to work out. And just briefly, we'll be flying at 15,000 feet. And you can put in course, winds, directions, and speed, and temperatures, and all that, but we don't need to. For in Europe, we'll change this. The reserves can be 2,000 or 3,000. We'll just put a 2 in there. Cost indexes, since I'm not paying for fuel, I'm gonna just pump it up a little bit. The zero fuel weight can be found. Let me get rid of that again. The zero fuel weight, there's the gross weight right here in the fuel quantity section. If you left click that button, it reveals the 103.6. Just briefly, see how it went away? 103.6, so 103.6. Put it in there. And then we did have we still have nearly 8,000. So we'll just put 8, and then we'll put a backslash, and then we'll put N, because we're following the nomenclature right here. Hopefully I didn't need to put the decimal in there. Nope, very good. Take off now, we'll do our V speeds, and they're not listed, we have to find those, so I just use Shift 5 as a quick way to do it. There's our numbers right here. So 116, and the next one is 123. Rotate, and then the last one is 131. And then I'm gonna put our speed up to 141, because we do 10 over the V2 for our departure speed initial, and Shift 5 takes care of those. And by the way, Just clicking at the top gives you your landing data. Here's your takeoff data. Just some nice references here for use if needed, and probably is needed. Let me just make sure I haven't overlooked anything. I think we're in good shape. That's about all we need to do right now. So I'll go ahead and put this back down. To get the V speeds to show up on our speed here, we're going to left click the top and they pop right open, and that gives us our V1, V2 rotate and flap retractions. And then if we click the bottom, it'll shut it down, but then if you click the bottom again, these are our landing indicators for our speeds there for flaps. So for right now, we'll just click the top. That's the only distinct difference between the top and the bottom, just to keep that in mind. Then we're going to go ahead and make sure our positions are all accurately set down here for trim. We've got 15.5 on the center of gravity, which is accurate. If it's not, the left side of this wheel can change all that as you choose with your mouse wheel. And if the flaps aren't right, look, it wants us to have 15, right? So 15 it is, but if we wanted to change that figure, we can roll the right side of the mouse wheel. The only other thing we need to worry about now is this white marker needs to come down here and level out with the green one for our trim. So left-clicking the long trim and holding it will bring it slowly down until you're looking for those two lines to be opposite each other. This takes a second. And when you let go of the left mouse, it should stop. There we go. And that's pretty much even. If you wanted to move it up, right-click it. But then you have to left-click it again to get it to stop. Kind of touchy, it looks like, isn't it? Better stop while we're ahead. And by the way, this is to do with the cabin pressure here. It's got two positions. Just leave it in that position. It shouldn't need any more attention than that. Okay, we're making good progress here. We're going to go ahead then and look at the buttons here for right there. There are six features. Takeoff is what we want. If we wanted to do takeoff flex to save the engine wear and tear and make our neighbors happy with less noise, we can calculate the assumed temp of the calculator that you can download from Fly the Mad Dog. That's usually used, and it's easy to do. I've done it, so don't be afraid of it. And then go around, maximum continual thrust, climb, and cruise. Those are the features there. Then we're going to do down to the glare shield numbers, which I think were in good shape, generally speaking. We've already preset many of them. By the way, this is VOR1 and the course, and the VOR2 is over here with the course. All these are easily changeable and very, very handy. So let's continue. The positive position strobe is over on the co-pilot's side. So let's kick it around over here. It's got two positions after off, position and both. The strobe, if it's even on both, the strobe is not going to work until the nose wheel lifts off the ground. But for right now, we'll just leave it on position. The anti-collision lights can be turned on. The floods on either side of the fuselage that point forward, you can turn those on if you want. And also the engine wing nacelles are going to be lit up with that. And why not? We've got them. Might as well use them. Then we're going to move over to the pilot side again. And we're going to look down here on these various knobs here. This one is automatic direction finder 2, and the outer gray one is automatic direction finder 1. Range, of course, and then, of course, we've seen this already. We've got nav aids, airports, data, and waypoints that we can also select. But generally speaking, I don't. And then, obviously, here too, you've got ADF, VOR, ADF, VOR. That's handy. Okay. Then we're going to go to TCAS standby. That's down here in the pedestal area, and it's already on standby. It's got alt off, alt on, and then it's got TA and TARA. TARA is if we're on the runway or airborne. TA is used if we're taxiing, perhaps. And then alt on and alt off is without the TCAS, and then standby, of course. And then if we're taking off, we'll want this to be above, in-flight norm on descent, below, because that just angles the antennas, so it'll pick up aircraft at those angles. And then here's our ranges right there. Comms are all super simple and straightforward and easy to use. And since we're looking down here, we can arm then our auto brake and roll it down to RTO or TO and call that one good. Alright. Then we're going to align our backup artificial horizon. Left click on that little gray knob. It should settle right into the horizontal. If not, I just clicked it again and it did. It settled in like it should. We've got our speed set. We've trimmed it. We've got our altimeter now ready at 29 or 9 or 1 with a B on the keyboard, or you can roll it in yourself. And now we're ready to get that start that we've been looking forward to. We could push back now if we wanted to, but no need in this case for demo. So turn on all the fuel pumps that are appropriate. The hydraulic pumps then, the engine needs to be on high, and the trans and the aux also. And remember, that's down here inconveniently, sort of, for the co-pilot. So left click, left click, left click, left click, both of them. Trans on, that's if you lose hydraulic power on one side, this will provide that necessary offset so we don't lose the hydraulics and keep it rolling. We've already got our auto brake set. Our pneumatic crossfeed valve is already available to us. We haven't done it yet. These white switches down here at the very, very bottom, I'm not sure I can, there we go. Left click both of them. It says right here what they are, very, very clear. And then on the engine section overhead, right in here, let's put system B, and then we're going to put the air, make sure the air conditioning supplies are still off, which they are. If it's freezing temperatures, turn on the fuel heat right here. There is some water condensation in these wings, they say, and it's good to have all those closed up. And then to start the engines, we're going to start the right one first, open up the cover, and click it down, and then we're going to look down here briefly. And what we're watching for is the N2 to get to 18, and when it does, we click the fuel lever here. So 15, 16, 17, coming along nicely. There, I clicked it, and then it's going to catch fire and run it up. And then the N1 will catch up. So exhaust gas temp's rising nicely. Just to hear that beep, that happened, the tone rather. When it hit 40, the generators from the engines took over the generators from the APU. And it'll happen also on the other side. So we can turn that off, close the cover, open the cover on the left, click on the left start. We'll do the same thing all over again, waiting for 18. And when it gets to 40, or 18, we'll turn on the fuel valve. And then when it gets to 40, we'll hear that tone all over again. So there comes 18. There, we opened up the fuel valve. It's catching. And when it gets to 40, we'll hear that tone. There it is. Okay, now the generators from the engines are carrying all the freight for us for the power. So we'll go ahead and close that up. All right. Air conditioning supply now. Just leave that alone for a second. Start pump can be turned off. The engine system knob here can be turned to off. The APU buses can be turned off. The APU master can be right-clicked off. The air can be off. So all of that now, the APU is off. Now watch, these do not move, and you may wonder why. It takes several minutes for it to wind down and cool down, but we'll see that eventually as the time goes by. All right, so left now and right air conditioning. We're going to left-click twice, left-click again twice, down to auto. And then we've got our hydraulics already on high. Now for taxiing, we're at that point where we could end the video. It didn't take too long. The air C supply is now on auto. The logo light we could turn on if we chose to, which is right up here. The flaps, which we should look at, will be 15. And it's worth noting a few things here. 0, 11, 15, those are standard. But let's say we wanted to have 20. Well, with the dial a flap here, we can roll that down. I'm moving my mouse wheel forward, and I'm going to create a new one. I'm right there on 20. So now, if I move it down, it jumped to what would normally be an unknown flap setting, except for the fact that I added it. So that's what the dial flap will do. So I'm going to go ahead and put the dial flap back up where it was, so we don't end up with that extra set. Especially when we're landing, we don't want to get confused. The nose light now could be turned on, which is here. And the signal flight attendants, if you wanted to. We could also get our clock started here. Just right click and then on there, and we can right click, and then on here left click, and that should get the clocks moving in both directions. We can arm the speed brake with a right click, and you see a little red band appear, as it should. The terrain radar switch is here, and I believe that'll also highlight. We're going to go ahead and turn it on over here as well. So those need to be on. The weather radar power is right there. I don't really see any activity, but you've got the power button, the TFRs, the transfer button that gets the shifting from one ND to the other ND. Weather-T is the weather and turbulence mode. WX is weather, map is radar ground map, and CSG is ground clutter suppression. So we've got the auto brake switch now to arm. The ART is here. And the ART is the automatic reserve thrust. And we want to leave it on auto unless we're using our takeoff flex. In that case, we want to turn it off. What that does is it takes over in case one engine goes out and gives more thrust to the one remaining. All right, now we can go ahead and either Shift P to back this thing out, or we can use GSX, or we can use the mech call feature at the very top left. That's it for my video. Thank you so much for your patience, and I hope it's been helpful. And I've no doubt missed something. There's so much going on here. In fact, if you